During the first few installments of Rise and Fall, we've explored quite a few former Cup Series programs, and even one Trek. However, we still have yet to discuss a team exclusively from the lower series until today, as I'd like to discuss one of my all-time favorite Trek Series exclusives, Red Horse Racing. Red Horse Racing first began operations in 2004 based in Mooresville, North Carolina, and it was the creation of former Mobile One marketing executive Tom DeLoach and former NASCAR broadcast personality Jeff Hammond, who had first bought the racing team from the family racing team of Brandon Witt, Clean Line Motorsports. Red Horse's trucks were always easy to recognize on a track. They competed with Toyota in the Tundra lineup, and despite more often than not competing without a sponsor, the team ran several full-time and part-time trucks, and they were known for their numbers featuring the simple white font numbers over a black box despite whether or not they had a sponsor. The team most recently fielded cars for Brett Moffitt and Timothy Peters until midway through 2017 when Tom DeLoach announced the team would shut down. And while the team would end up selling assets that would go towards David Gillen and Bo Lamassa's DGR Crossley Racing Team, I'd like to take a look down memory lane of this once great Truck Series team by exploring the history of the team going year by year, starting with 2005. When the team at Red Horse bought Clean Line Motorsports, they would keep Brandon Witt on as their driver, and they would keep him in their number 38 entry, but the team did not go with Ford F-150s as they would switch over to compete with Toyota and their Tundra race trucks instead. In the first season of Brandon Witt behind the wheel, the team showed great signs of progress, with Witt having an impressive average starting position of 9th, but unfortunately, the finishes would usually not reflect the same as he posted an average finish of 20th place. However, even with that stat in place, Witt would deliver the team 5 top 10s, with 2 of these being top 5s, and he would record 2 pole awards in 2005 as well, and at the site of his first pole award, Memphis, Witt would lead for 54 of 200 laps and score not only Red Horse Racing's first win, but also Witt's one and only win in the upper levels of stock car racing. While the win at Memphis was great, Witt still would only finish 18th in the final standings of the Craftsman Truck Series in 2005, and Red Horse Racing made a decision to bring in David Starr as their driver in 2006, this time piloting the number 11 truck for the team, and this would be the first season that the team used their iconic number font inside the black box. The driver change would prove to be a good move, as Starr was able to keep an average finish of 11th place while picking up 12 top 10, 6 top 5s, and he would score the team's second win in the Spring Martinsville race. The next year in 2007, David Starr signed to compete in a number 10 for Circle Bar Racing, while Red Horse Racing would cycle through 4 drivers in the 2007 season, renumbering their entry once again to the number 1. The first 12 races of 2007 would be ran by Aaron Fike, and Fike was originally supposed to be their only driver for the 2007 season, scoring 4 top 10s and 1 top 5 in his 12 starts for the team, but this was until an incident outside of Kings Island Amusement Park in Ohio. Police actually ended up arresting Fike and his fiancée Cassandra Davidson on charges of possession of heroin and drug paraphernalia. The incident led to NASCAR suspending him indefinitely, as well as his dismissal from the team, and he would never be seen in the racing world after this incident. At least not in NASCAR. Following the incident with Fike, Red Horse Racing brought in David Green for the next 7 races of 2007, who would score 1 top 5 at Kentucky, but would finish around 14th to 20th in the next races, resulting in another driver change, this time to Jason Leffler, who competed in 5 of the final races of 2007, with the exception of one race where Brandon Witt finished 23rd at Atlanta. As for Leffler, he would run really well, scoring 4 top 10s, with 3 of these being top 5s in these 5 starts as a team. The next season, in 2008, David Starr returned to Red Horse Racing, once again piloting the number 11 for the team, and he would go on to record 8 top 10s and 4 top 5s en route to a 12th place points finish, and after 2008, David Starr would leave Red Horse for the final time. The 2009 season would be a monumental year for the team, as they would field a total of 3 different entries that year. TJ Bell would compete full time in the number 11 for the team, scoring 5 top 10s and 1 top 5 en route to a 15th place points finish. Meanwhile, the team would acquire a second full time truck after 8 races in 2009 when they picked up Timothy Peters in a number 17 entry from Premier Racing with the backing of sponsor Strutmasters.com. Before the team change in 2009, Peters had an average finish of 17th, but the remaining 17 races would see Peters have an average finish of 9th place, and he would finish the 2009 season 8th in the point standing, scoring 1 pole award, 11 top 10s, 5 top 5s, and at the Fall Martinsville event, Peters would even earn his first career victory, and little did they know then, this would lead to many more of the team. In fact, Timothy Peters Peters would go on to become quite possibly Red Horse Racing's most iconic driver in their team's history, but let's not get ahead of ourselves just yet. 2009 would also see the entry of Red Horse's number one entry of veteran driver and defending Truck Series champion Johnny Benson, racing in 8 races to start the season, but the hope was that the defending Truck Series champion could pilot the number one truck all season. Unfortunately though, on June 8, 2009, the team announced that the number one would shut down due to a lack of funding. This was at least true up until Caitlin Shaw would make just one start in the number one at O'Reilly Raceway Park en route to a 24th place finish, but that would be the only other entry for 2009 with that truck. In 2010, Red Horse Racing once again ran 2 full-time entries with Timothy Peters back in number 17 and rookie driver Justin Lofton piloted number 7. The team would also field the number 11 in 2 races for Miguel Peluto, and they ran a number 1 with Nelson Piquet Jr. one time at Daytona. Justin Lofton would score the team a total of 8 top 10s and 4 top 5s, going on to finish 12th in the point standings, and the following season he would leave to compete for Germain Racing in a truck series. Timothy Peters, however, would once again have a great season for the team and start off a bang as Peters would win the 2010 opener at Daytona, and the season would also include 5 top 5s, 16 top 10s, and 2 pole awards as Peters went on to finish 2010 6th in the final point standings. The next year, in 2011, Red Horse Racing fielded Miguel Peluto full-time in a number 7 and Timothy Peters once again piloted a number 17 full-time. For Miguel Peluto, he would score 7 top 10s and 3 top 5s, and he led for 19 laps, and once again, Timothy Peters proved that he was the best of the Red Horse Racing trucks, scoring 1 pole award at Charlotte, 12 top 10s, 7 top 5s, and 1 win at IRP, finishing 5th in point standings that season. Now, 2012 would be the pinnacle year for this team. I say this because in 2012, a total of 4 drivers competed for the team, with Timothy Peters and Todd Bodine competing full time, and of these 4 drivers, they all scored at least 1 victory for the team that season. Let's start with John King. At the Daytona opener, driving number 7 for Red Horse Racing, John King from Kingsport, Tennessee, was able to put his name on a NASCAR map when he picked up the victory at Daytona, which would result in more opportunities for King with the team that season, in which he followed up his victory with a 9th place finish at Martinsville, but after 2 33rd place finishes, a 13th place finish, and the team's withdrawal at Dover, John King and Red Horse Racing would part ways in 2012. Then there was Parker Kligerman. When he had lost his ride of Brad Keselowski Racing midway through 2012, Kligerman was 6th in the point standings, so he really deserved to have a ride. That was when he found his new ride in number 7 of Red Horse Racing. During his 11 races with the team, he'd score 2 pole awards, 8 top 10s, 6 top 5s, and at Talladega, he would even score his first Truck Series victory driving for the number 7 team, and he would go on to finish the season 5th in the standings. Imagine, if he had not been able to pick up that ride of Red Horse Racing, the whole effort put in for 2012 would have been wasted. Then you had the legend in The Onion, Todd Bodine. Bodine was still in his prime and had recently won a title for the second time in his career, and many believed that he could be the one to win a championship for his team. However, unfortunately, 2012 would be a worse year than many ever predicted for Bodine, as he would score only 7 top 10s, 5 top 5s, but he would score a victory for the team at Dover in 2012. And this would actually be his final victory of his NASCAR career, and he would finish 2012 14th in the point standings. While Bodine could not materialize a championship for the team, Old Reliable Timothy Peters would prove why this was truly his team, as he would have Red Horse Racing's best opportunity to win a championship in 2012, scoring 2 pole awards, 16 top 10s, 10 top 5s, and 2 victories, resulting in a 2nd place finish in the standings, only 6 points behind 2012 champion James Buescher. 2013 would once again see Mr. Peters back in the number 17, and his team would also field Herman Quiroga full-time in the number 77, and John West Townley, powered by Zaxby's sponsorship, drove full-time for Red Horse Racing's number 7. So let's start with Townley, as this was his only season with the team before he'd go on to being remembered best in the Truck Series by pulling a DDT to Spencer Gallagher. John West Townley started 2013 on a good note by picking up a victory in ARCA at Daytona, driving number 15 Zaxby's Camry of Venturini Motorsports, which was actually the Venturini's first victory at Daytona in ARCA. While 2013 seemed to start well for Townley, he could not carry this over into his Truck Series efforts. With only 7 top 10s as well as an average finish of 14.9, Townley would finish 11th in the standings, driving for, at the time, one of the best teams in the series. With that being said though, he still did better technically than his teammate Herman Quiroga. Despite having 1 pole award and 2 top 5s, he still only had 6 top 10s in 2013 and an average finish of 15.8, which resulted in Kuroga finishing 13th in the standings. Now, as for Timothy Peters, the key driver at Red Horse, he would not have the year he had hoped for after very nearly winning a championship the year before. While his stats were good, having 11 top 10s, 4 top 5s, and wins at Iowa and Las Vegas, he still only finished 10th in the 2013 standings. I think this is mostly because while he did have great races, in 6 of his races, he would finish in 26th or worse, and too many finishes like that can really hurt a good season. Then we entered a 2014 season with a couple of new changes. NASCAR had developed the next generation of NASCAR racetrack, and Toyota had redesigned a Toyota Tundra pickup truck, which in turn led to a new look on a track for Red Horse Racing and the other top Toyota Racing teams. Hermann Caroga and Timothy Peters returned as the team's full-time drivers in 2014, with Brian Eichler competing in 5 races in the team's number 7 truck, where he would see 2 top 10s with 1 top 5 coming at Las Vegas. Caroga once again piloted number 77, while Peters would also once again drive the number 17. Caroga was able to record 10 top 10s and 3 top 5s during 2014, with a 6th place points finish just 1 spot below his teammate Timothy Peters, who recorded 13 top 10s, 9 top 5s, and 1 victory at Talladega. No surprise, Peters would also return to the 17 in 2015, but Caroga would not, nor would he compete in 2015 at all in NASCAR. However, current NASCAR Truck Series director Ben Kennedy would compete full-time for the team's number 11 truck in 2015, and the team would actually field Gray Galding in the number 7 Krispy Kreme truck for 1 race at Martinsville, in which he finished 17th before being picked up by KBM for 3 races in 2015. Driving the number 11, Ben Kennedy would score 1 pole award at Atlanta Motor Speedway and score 8 top 10s and 4 top 5s on his way to a 9th place points finish. Meanwhile, Timothy Peters would record a pole award at Talladega, which he would also win that season. That would be one of 2 victories for Peters in 2015, as he would also win the race at Phoenix as well. This would be supported by 8 top 5s as well as 16 top 10s to finish 5th in point standings that season. For 2016, the original plan was for the same driver lineup from 2015 to return for 2016, and at first this was the case, but after the 3rd race of 2016, Ben Kennedy announced that he was leaving to go to GMS Racing's number 33 team, which would be a good move as he would score a victory for the team at Bristol. This move would lead to a host of different drivers running the number 11 truck for the rest of 2016. Matt Tift competed in 10 races, scoring 3 top 10s and 1 top 5. Hermann Caroga would return to the team for 3 races that season, scoring 2 top 10s for the team. Jake Griffin would also make a one-off appearance for the team, finishing 4th at Eldora. However, the one driver who made the most out of their time in the 11 truck was Brett Moffitt. Brett made 6 starts for the team, recording 4 top 10s, 3 top 5s, and at Michigan, Brett Moffitt would make everything work out to record his first career victory in the Truck Series. Meanwhile, Timothy Peters would be their full-time driver for the 2016 campaign, getting 1 pole award, 16 top 10s, and 8 top 5s, finishing 4th in the point standings that season. Now, we didn't know it at the time, but 2016 would be Red Horse Racing's final full-time season. Going into 2017, the team was all set to field 2 full-time trucks, with Timothy Peters back once again into 17, and Brett Moffitt had been signed to drive the number 7 full-time. While the season started off looking well for both, with Moffitt scoring 2 top 10s and Peters gaining 3 top 10s with 1 top 5, a shocking announcement came from the team that after 13 years, there finally was not enough funding to continue to compete. The team would later be sold to the team of Bo Lamastis and David Gilliland in what is now DGR Crossley Racing. As for the team's 2017 drivers, Timothy Peters would make a start in a 99 and 2 starts in the 02 later in 2017, and he would make 5 starts in 2018, even scoring another victory at Talladega in a number 25 for GMS Racing, and he would make 4 starts in 2019, scoring a top 10 at Daytona. And as for Brett Moffitt, he would make 7 Cup Series starts for BK Racing's 83 car in 2017, and 1 start in a 96 car in the Xfinity Series in 2017, before going to race for Hattori Racing in 2018 in the Truck Series, in which he would famously score 6 wins, along with the 2018 Truck Series Championship. In 2019, he signed with GMS Racing's Truck Series team, where they scored 4 wins and made it to the Championship 4, finishing 3rd in the 2019 Truck Series Championship race. 13 years, 532 starts between 24 different drivers, 16 wins, 112 top 5s, 236 top 10s, and 14 pole awards, leading for 2,245 laps. These are stats that any Truck Series team should be proud of. They may not have been one of the most famous Truck Series exclusives in the history, but they for sure should should always be remembered as one of the most consistent in the modern era of NASCAR's truck series, and they were responsible for the success of many in the sport, especially Timothy Peters. And that's the story of Red Horse Racing's rise and fall. What were your thoughts on the team? Be sure to leave a comment down below, and if you enjoyed the video, then I ask you to please give the video a like, and if you're new to my channel or just want more content like this, please hit subscribe and be sure to turn on notifications. Know some other teams or facilities that should be covered in the series? Then leave a comment down below and they may just make it into future episodes. Until then though, thanks so much for watching and I hope you have a great day. Bye guys.